rose-colored glasses are off, it's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 33 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the pleasure of chatting with author and neuromarketing expert, Daryl Weber. Daryl is the author of Brand Seduction, How Neuroscience Can Help Marketers Build Memorable Brands. In his book, he explores the unconscious side of brands in a way that's inspiring for creative marketers. He's a branding consultant whose work has influenced many of the best brands in the world, including Coca-Cola, Nike, Johnnie Walker, Gatorade, Old Spice, and many more. So without further ado, let's hop into our interview with author Daryl Weber. Daryl, thanks so much for joining me.
Great to be here, Tommy. Thanks.
So you wrote the book Brand Seduction, which I must say I found very fascinating because, slight confession, I toyed with the idea of going into anthropology because I just find the human creature very, very fascinating. And you were able to talk about neuroscience and related to marketing, which is neuromarketing, which is a hot buzzword in the industry right now. But nobody starts out that way. Everybody has a story. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug? And how did you become enchanted with marketing?
Yeah, sure. So it started out, like you said, like I was just fascinated with how we as humans work and function and operate. And, you know, just the idea of how the mind works, how we move through this world and make decisions, even how our eyes work, all that fascinated me even as a kid. And I can remember thinking about TV commercials I saw and just wondering, how do these work? Are these really influencing people? Are they affecting people? You know, and I remember asking, you know, does advertising work on you, right? And everyone would say, no, of course not, right? I'm not influenced by ads. But then clearly ads are working and they're doing something. And that was sort of the key question. I was like, how are ads working and how does marketing work on us? And I wanted to explore that and I was fascinated by it. Yeah, so I studied psychology as an undergrad and then always just kept researching it. I was fascinated by marketing and advertising. I thought it was creative and interesting. So I got into the business. And as I've been working through my career through advertising agencies and I was at a brand strategy and innovation consultancy, and then client side at Coca-Cola. All that time, I was always curious, you know, how is the consumer mind really working? And really what sparked me to write the book was that I just saw so many misconceptions and myths around with consumer psychology. When you're talking to my colleagues in the business and clients, everyone thinks they know how ads work and how the consumer mind works. But everything I was reading from the science of it was showing that a lot of that's not true. You know, it's a common misconception because as we go through the world, our brain kind of gives us an image of what the world is and how it's working. And a lot of that is really just an illusion. Our brain's actually tricking us to make things easier and simpler for us to function every day, but it's not really how our brains work. So you get this kind of chasm that exists between how the brain works, how the mind works, and the scientists that are studying that, and then marketers who are on the other side of this and trying to figure it out and often think they know how it works, but there's a lot of sort of mistakes that they're making, and that's what really drove me to write the book.
Awesome. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that sort of shiny veneer come off? And it's like, you know what? I just saw a terrible commercial or this billboard sucks. Now I'm writing a book. Like, can you name a specific example that really gave you the impetus to like, look, I got to step in?
There's probably a lot of things. I mean, there's a lot of bad ads. I'm sure we've all seen them. But it wasn't just that. I think it was working client side. You know, I was working at Coca-Cola, amazing company, amazing brand with really smart marketers and some of the best brands in the world globally. So a lot of great stuff, but I would just hear things like this. People would say, and I'm sure many of your listeners have said something or thought something like this too, is, you know, we have to reach our consumers emotionally, right? Everyone's saying that. It's like, oh, we need to be more emotional in our ads, right? Modern marketers today, I think, know you can't just be totally rational and, you know, talk about the functional claims of your product or services or the benefits of it. So everyone's trying to be a bit more emotional. But I just saw like no one really knows what that means. You know, everyone's saying, oh, we have to be more emotional. But I'm like, what do you mean by that? So, and I just saw these mistakes in advertising where every like viral ad seems to try to make you cry, right? There's like soft piano music and there's like something super touching. So I was like, okay, marketers are trying to elicit emotions really literally, is one way I think it's being misinterpreted. And the other way was all these strategy documents, right? I work as a brand strategist. So I see all these internal brand architectures and brand onions and brand wheels and things like this. And they all have these really emotional sort of grandiose claims that they want a brand to stand for. And I was like, this also isn't really what neuroscientists mean when they talk about emotions and how emotions influence our decision making. And that's where I thought, okay, there's clearly a big misunderstanding here. And I was like, I think I can help explain it, especially for creative marketers. My goal was like, let's translate some of this science so that those marketers can really understand what emotions actually are and how they influence our decisions.
Absolutely. Myself and my co-author wrote a book in 2016 called Beyond Buzzwords. By far, the buzzword of 2016 was influencer marketing. And you had a lot of podcasts around it. Jay Baer, Convince Converse, he launched the Influence Pros podcast. And we just had an influencer marketing debacle with Pepsi and Kendall Jenner because, you know, they were trying really hard to elicit emotion, as you were talking about, and they just flat out missed the mark. So can you talk a little bit about brand versus brand fantasy that you mentioned in your book, and how, from a strategic standpoint, you mentioned you're a brand strategist, what strategic tools could Pepsi have used to sort of, you know, not foresee, but, you know, stave off the controversy that they had? Because just for those who may not know, Pepsi ran a YouTube ad featuring Kendall Jenner of the Kardashian crew. And it was, you know, civil unrest. And then you had Kendall Jenner break across the crowd line and hand Pepsi to a police officer. And, you know, Bob's your uncle, everything's fixed. And of course, there was outrage because they're like, seriously, you're going to try to profit off of all of the turmoil and do it in such a ham-fisted way. So yeah, talk a little bit about you know, brand versus brand fantasy and how strategically Pepsi could have averted this crisis of trying to elicit emotion.
I guess I'll start with some of the Pepsi things. I think that there was a fundamental error there that I think a lot of clients make, where they see their product as the most important thing in the world, right? And they think it's this amazing thing, it's top of mind for their consumers. And, you know, internally, they probably talk about it like that and as this world-changing thing. But to most people, it's still just a soda, right? And when they put it in this situation where it's solving very serious world problems, it's just so much of an overreach that it came across as tone deaf. And I think marketers need to be sort of more aware of really how their consumers think about their brands and relate to their brands and connect with their brands. I think often they fall into this trap of over-exaggerating and expecting it to be this big thing in their lives that can have these big changes, when more often than not, it's just a small thing. They don't think about it too much. So they, you know, that's a classic example of that. But so this does relate to my idea of a brand and a brand fantasy. My definition of a brand is that it's a collection of associations in consumers' minds. And this comes from the idea of in cognitive science for how we as humans relate to or any concept in the world or anything. So anything we encounter, a person, a thing, an object, it exists in our mind as a network of associations. So if you take the idea of a doctor, let's say, the idea of doctor is connected to all these other associations in your mind, whether you realize it or not, most of it's unconscious. So even me saying the word doctor activates this network, and things like nurses and hospitals and sickness and pills, you know, are all sort of activated subconsciously as well. And there's this vast network that exists with it. Brands are no different. You encounter a brand like Pepsi, it's going to have this vast network of associations and connections in your mind from everything you've seen with that brand, you know, your whole life, you know, if it's existed that long. So everywhere you've seen a Pepsi, people you've seen drinking it, the logo, the colors, the fonts, even like the lighting, the tonality, all those things are encoded in your memory typically without you realizing it, and are connected to your idea of what that brand is. And all that kind of adds up to an emotional feel you have towards that brand, like a gut feel of what you feel Pepsi is about, right? And again, you probably don't think about it too much. It's not super conscious, but you have a sense for what Pepsi is and is about. And this makes sense sort of evolutionarily. As we're going through the world, we wanted to be able to quickly process things and know if they were good or bad for us. So our unconscious mind was actually always evaluating things in the world and telling us if they're positive or negative. So when you came upon something, you had a sense for, is this a good thing? Is this a bad thing? Should I avoid it? Should I try to move towards it or not? And that's how we relate to brands. And so if you think of brands that way, that they are this collection, this network of associations, I thought we should be smarter about what that collection is. And so what I call the brand fantasy is really just a model, a way of sort of capturing that network and putting it on paper and making it a bit more tangible so that we as marketers can then work with it and try to shape and mold it strategically. Whereas right now, I think it tends to happen almost by chance, right? All these little things you're doing as a company, every touch point a consumer has with your brand is all influencing and shaping and molding that pile of connections. But if we can be a bit smarter about it and plan it out through this brand fantasy model and just kind of, you know, see what are those close-in associations that we have? What are the broader ones? You know, all that is influencing how people feel and relate to our brand. And it gives you a much more real sense for how your brand exists in your consumer's mind versus how you might think about it or, you know, how Pepsi really got it wrong there. If they were more aware of what a Pepsi really is and what it stands for and is not sort of this world-changing device, I think they may have been closer to the mark.
Yes, indeed. In fairness, you know, hindsight is always 20/20, but sure. Clearly somebody, you know, fell asleep at the wheel there. So since we're looking back, if you had a time machine, you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Mm-hmm. Yes, I watch Doctor Who. What are the top three things you would tell yourself to help prepare for your career?
I'll be very honest here. one thing I kind of realized early on was that confidence seems to play a huge role just in the workspace, right? So I, by nature, I come from sort of a science background and a science mind, although I have a creative side too. I'm a musician. But in the work world, I'm fascinated by science. But I'm always questioning things and I never feel like I'm totally sure about something unless I've seen it from a million angles and it's been really proven. So in the working world, I would tend to propose things as a theory or a hypothesis or a question that we should maybe test or look at. And I realized maybe that doesn't go as far as you'd like it to in a business setting. And I realized so many other people are just boldly, confidently claiming things and saying things, even if they're not totally sure about it. and I'm not saying to lie or to put yourself out there if you're not sure about something, but just having that confidence in what you're saying, I think, as I've seen so many people get really far in that, right? It impresses clients or the people or colleagues and just allows you to command a room and know what you're talking about. But I still think the science part of me is always going to be like cautioning and being wary of that kind of thing. But I would tell myself to be a bit more confident. You have studied these things. You do know what you're talking about. So go for it. You know, I've always tried to sort of read outside of work and open my mind to many different influences. I would say, you know, keep doing that as much as possible. I tend to get sort of stuck down certain rabbit holes. Some were good, like that led me to like write this book. So I read a ton about consciousness and decision making and emotions and memory and the unconscious and all that. You know, has led me to this kind of area of consulting that I'm in the book. But I think it's super important for anyone to just keep an open mind and look at lots of different inputs and read and talk to people and go to things and that you maybe normally wouldn't, because especially in marketing, you have to be connected to culture in general, beyond what your particular interest or your bubble might be, you know, right? So lots of different influences, I think, and different sources of material can just help you better connect with people, know what's going on in the world, and all that can be helpful in creating marketing strategies and creating products that are connected with people, right? You never know where that inspiration is going to come from. So I think saying yes to everything and exploring everything you can.
Now, that makes a lot of sense. And that spoke to me specifically because I'm actually introverted by inclination. A lot of people don't believe me when I say that because I can be very charismatic and outgoing when the situation calls for it. But in my natural state, I'm an introvert. And like yourself, I tend to, you know, pose things as hypotheses. And sometimes that can be misinterpreted as a lack of confidence. And, and so I've had to make a conscious effort to be more bold and say things like that. So that, yeah, that's a big takeaway for me personally. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future, because one of the areas of marketing that I have a particular interest in is mobile / connected devices / the Internet of Things, whatever you want to call it. And sort of the default example that everyone gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered via Amazon drone. And they call that a closed loop system, because in that example, you don't actually have to leave the house. It's, you know, sort of like the Jetsons. It's on automatic and everything just happens. And that's, as you state in your book, that's kind of how our minds work, right? We have a lot of things that go on subconsciously in the background that our minds just sort of take care of without us really having to think about it. Sort of how our eyes work, for example, that you mentioned. You know, our eyes take things in black and white, it's upside down, kind of fuzzy, and our brain just sort of, you know, takes care of the rest. So so imagine it's 2045, right? And we live in the reality of the Jetsons, the singularity has taken place. I would imagine that given your background in neuroscience, you're the type of individuals that companies will consult when they try to, you know, operate in this space. So when everything is automated to the 10th degree and, you know, we don't have to leave our houses anymore, how would you advise brands on how to function in this new reality, and what do you see marketing looking like?
Yeah, sure. No, it's a good question. There's one thing I want to remind people of, and that's, you know, technology is changing quickly and all the time, sure. But we have to remember that ourselves as humans, we've stayed almost identically the same for thousands of years, hundreds of thousands of years, right? We've been, since we evolved to our current state, it's really at least 100,000 years, right? Where our brain is still the same. So we're using that ancient neural machinery to function in today's world, which is a very different place, right? And so even when you're looking 40, 50 years in the future, that's nothing by evolution standpoint. So our brains are going to stay the same, right? The evolution, the technology around it is going to keep evolving and changing, but it's always going to be formatted and it has to fit with the same neural circuitry that we have that evolved on the savannas to keep us alive as hunter-gatherers, right? And I think actually, well, two things. One, there is a huge shift now towards understanding the mind. As like you said, neuroscience, neuromarketing is a very hot topic. I think we're very early days in that still. So we are just going to continue to get smarter about how the brain works, how it influences us, how the unconscious works. I think we're still just kind of scratching the surface on a lot of that. So as we get smarter about that, I think technology is going to start integrating with neuroscience much more. It's going to be much more seamless and human-oriented and fit with how our minds work. And maybe we're going to even notice the technology less and less as it possibly even becomes more integrated into us. We become slightly bionic, right? And we start adding onto our brains. You can almost think of our phones today as an extension of our brain, right? Like you can look up anything in Google. You don't really have to remember any sort of facts and figures anymore. It's all there at the push of a button in your phone. It's just external, right? What if that starts to become internal? So I can see huge advances in those kinds of things, especially when you look at virtual reality and augmented reality. I think there's a ton of potential there. And we're just obviously scratching the surface with that. As that becomes more mainstream and more fluid with the technology, you can just see technology and our natural perception and how we move through the world just sort of integrating seamlessly. And so, you know, as brands and marketers, as we start to think about functioning in that world, again, I think we got to go back to we as humans, how we relate to things. And this idea of networks of associations and gut feelings towards and against things, that's not going to change. That's how we're hardwired as humans. That's going to stay true for thousands of years from now, just like it has. So the mediums might change and the technology might change, but the way we relate to things and brands won't. And that's why I think we need to be smarter about that. And I hope my books, you know, is one step towards that. And I'm sure there'll be lots more to come.
I dig it. And I tend to agree. We as marketers, we tend to throw the baby out with the bathwater whenever something new comes along. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, X is going to kill Y and this and that. But to your point, we are fundamentally unchanged from 100,000 years ago. So as long as there are people, there will be a need for marketing, and it will fundamentally be the same. It might change forms, but you know, it's still marketing. So lovely answer. I really dig it. We are going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Daryl Weber. So stick with me.
We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon.
And we're back. So, Daryl, you, Gary Vee, and Brian Solis, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference, Jay Bear, whoever, you're all sitting at the bar after a conference having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing industry, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Wow. Yeah, I'd love to be having drinks with some of those guys. That'd be awesome. I think I would talk about, again, I fall back to these like misconceptions and myths about how we relate to brands and how we think these ads are working. So I think there's a good movement now in the digital marketing community to focus on behavior, right? And A/B testing. And you almost don't need to know why something works. You can just see if it works better than another version, right? And sort of keep testing and getting your way towards better and better performance and success with marketing. But I think we can be smarter about what we're putting into those tests. And by the way, I think that's a good evolution. We should be testing things. It's often very hard to sort of guess what's going to work better than others. And often our intuition about what we think is going to appeal to people may not be the best, right? So definitely agree with A/B testing. And I think that's been a great evolution with digital marketing. But I think what we're putting into test is still driven by what we think is going to work, right? And we can take a bunch of guesses, but we're still, it feels like guessing at what those things are. So I just want to be better at that upfront phase, right? I think there's a lot of good testing, like once you have marketing materials developed that we can test, but thinking more upfront when we actually brief creatives or designers, you know, advertisers, people who are going to make these marketing materials for us, how can we be smarter about crafting that message and those ideas of what a brand is going to stand for and what it's going to put out in the world that's really going to appeal to people, not even consciously, because I think we're still stuck on that. I think there's this huge conscious illusion where we try to appeal to people's conscious minds, even if it's not rational. I think we've moved past, you know, just rational, like I mentioned earlier. But now it's like about how are we going to understand how we're connecting to people unconsciously, because all the science is showing that that's really where the decisions are made and that's how people are choosing their products. Often the conscious mind is just post-rationalizing and justifying the decision the unconscious mind already made. So I think there's huge opportunity there. And I think that's where the future could go is, can we get smarter about how we're talking about our brands in a way that's talking to that unconscious mind? And I'd love to see if anyone else is playing in that space, because I just think that's an untapped opportunity.
Makes a lot of sense. I listened to a podcast called Business of Story, and the host, Park Howe, he quoted someone whose name escapes me at the moment, but he said that our conscious mind is just the PR department for our unconscious mind, right?
Yeah.
So we make decisions and then we rationalize it. So makes a lot of sense. So speaking of rationalizations, without getting political, what's your take on the whole fake news fallout after the 2016 U.S. presidential election? And just to define some terms for those who may not know, in the last 3 months of the U.S. 2016 presidential election, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, I mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality. It was not a simple matter of spinning the facts one direction or another, which all news does. There were no underlying facts to be spun. Like, these were fairy tales, basically. And after the results came out, Mark Zuckerberg said, oh, no. It's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the outcome of the election. But then in his February 2017 open letter, he conceded that fake news has outstripped Facebook's current ability to govern it. And they are in the process of rolling out artificial intelligence, or AI, and third-party verification to try to curb the effect of fake news. And this has, you know, sparked a very interesting debate in the digital marketing community as to whether or not Facebook should be doing anything at all, because you have some people who are strictly First Amendment and who are like, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth and saying what people can and cannot say. And then other people are like, Facebook is a digital property, and as property owners, they are ultimately responsible for what goes on their property. It's no different than, let's say, you're away on business and some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool and one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. It doesn't matter. It happened on your property, so you are ultimately responsible. So again, without getting political, strictly speaking on the digital marketing side, in terms of how Facebook is governing its platform, what's your opinion on that?
Yeah, I think it's one of the major issues that came out of this election is that we, as a society, have lost our fundamental definition of truth, you know, what it means to be factual. And if we can't agree on the facts and the truth, how can you even have a conversation, right? So it's really dangerous and worrying, honestly. And it taps into something fundamentally true about human nature. Again, evolutionarily, this is one of the heuristics, they're called, sort of shortcuts that our brain and mind takes to make things easier for us. And there's one that fake news is tapping into in particular, confirmation bias. You may have heard of that. It's kind of one of the more popularly known heuristics, and there's sort of hundreds of these defined. But confirmation bias is the idea that we tend to believe things we want to believe and seek out information that we already agree with. So when people are, you see some of this fake news stuff, if it feels like something they want to believe, if it feels like it's on their side, right? Tribalism is a deeply ingrained human nature thing as well. If it feels like, yeah, this is on my team, they're predisposed to want to believe it and want to buy into it. And they're not going to think about it critically and say, oh, is this true? Should I check these facts? Should I bet? Is this backed up? They're just going to believe it. And there's a lot of research supporting this, showing that, you know, confirmation bias and other related heuristics are very powerful and that can really influence our decisions and our even our perception of reality. And we have no awareness that it's happening, right? So you don't even know this is happening, but you'll be buying into things that you want to believe. And there's actually some fascinating research that shows even if you're then given conflicting information, like something that says, no, what you just heard or read is not true, and here's some things that support it. If that goes against what you want to believe, it's very difficult for people to switch their mind. There's a certain threshold at which they actually will switch. But at first, a little bit of conflicting evidence often actually makes them believe even more in what they believed at first because they want to believe it. They'll argue against it. They'll find some other rational way to argue around it. And it's just the way the mind works. We want to have these sort of set ideas and policies, and it makes it easy for us to kind of live and you know, have our beliefs. And when you challenge those beliefs, it's very difficult. And it takes a lot to overcome them. And what's shown is even if you try to argue with them factually, you can actually have this backfire effect where you reinforce the false belief. So it's really a deep hole that we can get stuck in. And clearly we have, as people are believing many kinds of conspiracy theories and things with no factual basis, like you said. So it's very dangerous. It's tapping into this way that the mind has been programmed to work. And we don't know what's happening, so it's hard to fight against. The first step is sort of being aware of it, right? Like anything. So, you know, hopefully now your listeners are slightly more aware of it. When you are seeing something that feels really easy to believe, right? You want to buy into it. Just maybe stop for a second and try to think critically and say, am I just believing this because I want to believe this? Is this a factual source? Like, should I trust this source? All those kinds of things. Just try to think critically. We can use our conscious mind to sort of force those rules on it and not get caught up into it. But it is hard to do. You do have to sort of force it consciously. But kind of being aware of it can help a little bit.
I love that. Deep waters, my friend, deep waters. And you mentioned confirmation bias. If you would talk a little bit about the heuristic cognitive dissonance, because something I think is important to be said is that these people aren't stupid. Okay. And it's like there are certain things going on that they might not necessarily be aware of, because as you mentioned with confirmation bias, you know, even in light of some pretty damning evidence against the, you know, an inappropriate relationship with Russia and how President Trump was flat out dishonest. He said he wouldn't take a paycheck. He did. He criticized President Obama for playing too much golf. He's played multiples more golf than President Obama ever did in his first year. But it's like, you know, it's just a very powerful thing. And I don't want... I guess what I'm getting at is that, you know, Facebook can become very toxic because you got, you know, people basically at each other's throats. And it's like, look, these people aren't stupid. These people aren't, you know, retarded or ignorant or anything like that. But there's a lot going on behind the scenes. So if you could just talk a little bit more about cognitive dissonance and how as marketers, you know, we can wrestle with that without, you know, going for the jugular and being a little bit more understanding.
Right. Yeah, our brains don't like cognitive dissonance. It's hard. It challenges us. And our brain wants to be as efficient as possible. So the opposite of it is cognitive fluency, where something just fits with what you already believe. It's really easy to process and understand. And those things get into memory really easily and stay really strongly. So we as marketers always want really fluent communications, meaning very simple and easy to process, and the message just gets through seamlessly. What you're talking about in the Facebook feeds relates to another heuristic called the availability bias, which is the idea that the more you see something around, the more you hear something, the more prevalent you think it is, and the more powerful or impactful you think it is, even if that's not true. So, you know, we tend to live in our Facebook bubbles and see the same things being posted a lot. Those things then take on greater importance in our mind. For example, you know, we hear a lot about terrorist shootings and mass killings. And of course, those are horrible, terrible things. But the reality is they're a tiny percentage of the people that are killed, right? It's like statistically, infinitesimally small, the chance that you would be killed in a terrorist attack or a mass shooting, because they very rarely happen, right? Things like car accidents happen all the time, every day. You're far more likely to be killed in a car accident, but we don't tend to fear that or talk about it, right? Or even heart disease or diabetes, right? These are the big killers. But we're not talking about that. We're talking about this tiny little thing that, you know, that kills a small number of people, not to diminish it, of course, but that's the availability heuristic at work. And the media is playing a big part of that. So you know, there's all these things going on. The more we hear about something, the more we talk about something, tapping into fears people have, even if they're irrational. And I think Trump, this was successful in his campaign, tapping into these fears, even if they don't make sense. It really drives people to action and fires them up, even if it's not likely to affect their lives at all.
Thank you for talking about that, because I'm originally from Dayton, Ohio. I'm in Atlanta now, which is also a red state, but I'm originally from Dayton, Ohio. And, you know, I have Republican friends. I have quite a few libertarian friends from back when I did real estate investment. And it just got nasty, man. Like, I had to unfriend a couple people, and, you know, I'm sure folks unfriended me. And again, I really think that these things need to be discussed in a marketing context, because, you know, it's important to understand that these are otherwise intelligent people, that they really are not stupid, maybe a little bit too trusting. But, you know, these are things that really do need to be put in the conversation, because it was just ridiculous how vicious the discourse got, and it really wasn't necessary. So yeah. I think that your book and understanding the concepts of why these things are the way they are makes a lot of sense, because love them or hate them, something you cannot take away from POTUS 45 is that he is one hell of a brander and one hell of a marketer. Like, the man knows what he's doing, right? We can argue all day about if that's good or all bad, but the point is that he's very effective in getting specific outcomes. So
sure. Yeah, I want to make one point. You're saying they're not stupid. That's for sure. And all these biases I'm talking about, and the way the mind works, that, you know, seems like, oh, that might apply to other people, right? We tend to think, oh, right, those other people are influenced by those things, but I'm not. But we have to realize we all are, right? This is how human brains work. So I myself am influenced by these things, right? You are, everyone is. But it's very easy to think, oh, that doesn't apply to me. But we have to remember we're all can easily succumb to many of these biases, and we do every day. So we have to remember that.
Absolutely. Each and every last one of us. And understanding that with books like yours, Brand Seduction, maybe we can be a little bit more compassionate and not be so bad to each other. Yeah. Last question, and I'll let you back to your day. And I really do appreciate you taking the time. It is a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast. But I'm steering it in a very particular direction, and I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. So in my personal and professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I'm referring to someone who works in-house at a brand or agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you can absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. It's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, right? And in terms of professional oneself, there's sort of three main tracks that people take. The first is to just Google it. And while there is a lot of good information out there, contrary to popular belief, rooting it out does take a little bit of actual skill. You might land on Convince and Convert. You might end up doing Amway. Like, who knows where that Google rabbit hole goes, right? You can do what I did, which is go back to school and get a bachelor's degree in internet marketing. The cons there is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my undergraduate. Plus, it's time consuming, because even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. But by far the most prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best in class practices is through conferences and seminars. The cons there is that even though in aggregate, it's a lot less expensive than getting a bachelor's degree, you have to have that money up front. So take some of your better conferences like a South by Southwest or Social Media Marketing World, you're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That does not include your flight. That doesn't include your hotel, Uber, eating out for how many days. After you add all that stuff back in, you're looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And a lot of people just cannot afford that out of pocket expenditure. And so what I'm trying to do is crowdsource, if you will, a way of professionalizing oneself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to borrow against your life insurance policy to afford a conference out of pocket. So now that I'm done rambling for however many minutes, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right. You are college freshman broke, Daryl. You have somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
If you have the experience and you're able and the knowledge already, I think it's the first step would be to start positioning yourself as a thought leader and finding your own niche, right? Like there's everyone's out there trying to contribute in their own way, but not that many people are really taking a stand and finding their unique spin on it. So I'd start with doing a combination of reading lots of different things, getting a lot of different opinions and books and articles on how things are working today, and then formulating your own sort of theory and hypothesis on how things are working, and then putting that out there, right? Like start writing your own articles, whether that's on Medium or publishing on LinkedIn, things like that, starting to get those in front of people, and just start to become known as in whatever niche you think you can own, like whatever your personality, your background, your particular talents can bring to it, and be known as that person, that guy or girl that is known for that thing, and get it out there as much as possible so that people can start thinking of you as the expert in that, as the person to go to for that kind of thing. And, you know, now there's so many ways to sort of publish and get yourself out there as a thought leader, like yourself doing a podcast, writing, of course, speaking once you can get some of those. And you start building that name for yourself. All that is free to do. And you start to be seen as someone who knows what they're doing and knows what they're talking about. And all the information to kind of get there is out there available, much of it for free or, you know, at least pretty cheap in the sense of books. So I think just like finding that niche and like what you can own, I think is super important, being the expert in something and what you think you can contribute and help people with. Going after that and owning it. And as long as you yourself are passionate about it and into it and believe in it, I think other people will buy into it too. And yeah, hopefully you can build some kind of a reputation that way. I'm on that journey myself right now with this, the neuroscience of marketing stuff. And I wrote the book out of sort of passion because I was interested and fascinated by that. And I thought it would be helpful for me to know and the people I was working with to know. And that's why I thought other people would find it interesting and helpful as well. So hopefully it is. I'm trying to follow that path myself.
Daryl, this has been enlightening and absolutely tremendous. Please take a moment. Give us all of your social media handles. Where can we find you online? Tell us about Brand Seduction. Where can we get some more of you?
So the best place is probably my website. It's my name. It's daryl-weber.com. So daryl-weber. You'd probably tell me as a digital marketer I shouldn't do the dash, but that's just what happened. And then on Twitter, you can find me at @brandedcortex. And yeah, those are probably the best places. Yeah, the book is Brand Seduction. It's available at Barnes & Noble, on Amazon, anywhere you can find books. So check that out if you're interested. And if anyone wants to reach out to me, ask questions, you can do that on the website or through Twitter. I'm always happy to chat with people.
And there you have it, folks. Branded Cortex on Twitter. Daryl, thanks so much for taking the time.
Thanks so much, Tommy.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.